I talk about this as a passport for success,
because it really can be a successful experience if, like any trip, we prepare for it, we get the proper documents, we take time to plan and strategize. Thank you. Now, today we're going to discuss several things in the two parts of this presentation. First of all, we'll be talking about how ADHD impacts students at college. Secondly, we'll be talking about some of the factors that lead many to have transition challenges. We're going to be talking about how to better prepare in high school or as transitioning freshmen for college success. We're going to be talking about where you get the help on campus once you are here. And we'll also be talking about medication and how that may help students. We will be talking about useful accommodations at the college level, because although you read these books and you see lists and lists and pages of accommodations, they may not all be useful to you. And that's, again, an important point. First of all, for those students here, or for their parents who are looking at someone going to college, I want to say congratulations. You've gotten in. You've been successful in high school. Clearly, you've gotten this far. So you have the resources to be a college student. And that's the first step. Because getting into college is only half the battle. The goal is to graduate from college. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. How can we use what's available to us to be able to be successful? The picture is pretty bleak sometimes when we look at these groups, when we talk about the problems that they are having. College students with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder are more likely to have lower grades. They're also more likely to be on other students. Longer to graduate than other students. Graduation rate for other students with other disabilities, even. And I think the most important one is that they may struggle. They are here. Really coping with the transition to independent living at the college level. We're going to talk about why in a minute. But they have a lot of difficulty with self-management skills. Think about it. I always talk about, when I talk about college students, I talk about a couple groups. One of the groups are the clean slate groups. They say, I'm going off. Nobody knows who I am. I don't need to go see anybody. I used to see a psychiatrist. I used to have a tutor. I used to have special services. I used to take medication. I used to go to my doctor. And my mom was kind of like, you know, the manager. I don't have any of that with me. And nobody here knows. So they go off, and they don't understand that the reason why they got in the college in the first place was because they had that team. But they're ready to just chuck it all and say, here I am, I can do this on my own. There's another group of students that we see that they've been successful in high school, probably because of all these supports. And suddenly they get to college and they get their first C or D or F. And they go, oh my God, what's happening? I never got a bad grade before in my life. And now I am. That's another group that we say, oh, something's going on here. I don't quite know what it is. There's another group of students who can still, because of their intelligence, maintain it academically when they get here. But they are significantly overwhelmed. When they were home, their mother usually made dinner or had dinner available. They or their mother, usually their mother, did their laundry. So they were free to spend as long as they wanted rewriting those papers, staying up at night studying. You know, the money was in Dad's wallet, the food was in the kitchen refrigerator, and their clean clothes were in their drawers. That doesn't happen in college. You have to go get your own food. You have to go to the ATM and plan. You have to even decide who are going to be your friends. Before, you know, you were friends with the kids that you went to school with. On campus, you now have to pick your friends. So you have a lot of other things you need to add to the schedule that you already were treading, you know, those little ducks they were treading as fast as you could to keep up academically. And there aren't more than 24 hours in any day, so you're kind of overwhelmed by what's going on when you get to college. And a lot of them, for the first time, find that they come smack up against their ADHD and they can't be as successful as they were before with that. So why is the transition to college? We mentioned a few things, but first of all, college life is dramatically different than high school. We say, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit more, we say, you know, you have no parents at college with you. This afternoon, we're going to decide how to work on that balance. You also don't really have teachers at college. You have instructors and professors who are interested in a certain narrow area of content that they are trying to convey to you, but they are not educators in the sense of the teachers in high school who are trying to educate you. So there's a difference. So we always say, no parents, no teachers, no homework. There's no homework in college. You have long-term assignments, you have long-term papers, you have long-term projects. But it's not like at high school where every day you had homework, you went home and did it, and you turned it back the next day. That's a big difference. And as far as accommodations are concerned, yes, there are accommodations, but they're different than in high school. In high school, you were identified, and they made sure you got the accommodations. As you know, at college, you have to self-disclose and get the services you need. So there's a very big difference in what has been going on for you and how things were set up for you in high school versus how they're now set up for you in college. So college is very different than high school. Also, there's an increased academic expectations. You know, again, in high school, eventually you may have had two tests on the same day, or you may have had a syllabus that gave you a rough outline of what was going on. But here, you can get a syllabus the first day and no one asks you whether you're following that syllabus and how you're dividing up your time and how you're dealing with it until you get to the final exam. Very different. And you're expected to turn in much different work and to do a lot of this work on your own. I'm going to talk about it in a different way later, but I want to bring up now. Often classes only meet three times a week. Or twice a week. Wednesday, Friday, I have Tuesdays and Thursdays. I say, you do? That's wrong. You have Tuesdays and Thursdays off so you can do the work you're supposed to do for the Monday, Wednesday, Friday classes. And we know for people with ADHD, if it doesn't need to be done now, it doesn't need to be done. So I would say, because you'll say, well, what do you do? Oh, Mondays and Fridays, I sleep, I go play this, I go do this. So, you know, Tuesdays and Thursdays, all days off. That's why I tell them, get a part-time job and do some. So again, different academic expectations in college. Different laws mandate services. Before they were used to 504s and IEPs. That's not what we're talking about here. And again, if you have been able to navigate this maze in high school, you're going to have to navigate it in a different stream almost at the college level. And a lot of this is up to the professors. Whereas in high school, you know, the teachers through the IEP were expected to deliver certain services for you. And we know, again, dealing with the impact of ADHD can make college very, very difficult for these students. The learning issues that come up for these students are somewhat difficult. weaknesses and problems, sometimes without a formal diagnosis of LD. That usually comes up in the area of reading comprehension or paying attention when you read, so that after you finish reading something, you have no idea what you've just read. That happens to everyone if a little bit. You know, you'll be a couple pages or a few paragraphs and you'll say, oh, I don't know what I'm doing. With ADHD, this happens all the time for long periods. So what happens with them is they usually have to reread and reread and reread in order to get the information. That takes a lot longer. So we know that there's a lot of difficulty here, particularly with reading comprehension, and you have a lot more reading to do than you did before over a shorter period of time. So that's something that comes up as well for these students. We know that students with ADHD are less efficient learners. We just talked about one way that they are, and that they have to read frequently. But they also have difficulty recalling the information on demand. I was like, you know, the mother said to me, well, this is not at college. Well, I worked with him the night before and we answered all the questions. We went over all the definitions and he just knew everything. He comes home and he gets an F. Yes, they did know all the information. But to be able to get it from here, out here on the paper, is a very difficult thing. And they have a lot of trouble with recall and with the ability to produce what they already know. So I think that that's another issue we have for them. They have problems with short-term memory and working memory. Again, that's part of the recall of information. But they also have difficulty organizing materials and planning ahead and strategizing, which affects them as far as writing those papers. Why we need writing centers here. Because they have difficulty holding this in their mind long enough to be able to work with it. The executive function piece also, I remember working with one student who came to me and he said, it's not that I don't have an idea for the paper that I want to write. I have too many ideas. I can't choose one. Or an architecture student at Catholic University that was my patient, who they had, you know, they have to build the scale models of the project that they're working on. And they had 4 weeks to do this one model in. Well, he changed his project four times within that period of time. So the model that he handed in, he had only worked on for about four or five days. Versus the model that the guy next to him had turned in, where he had worked for 5 days. I mean, 4 weeks or 5 weeks on that model. So you can see the difference here, again, that it will make in production and in the work that they do because of these weaknesses or learning issues that they have. They also have difficulty recognizing as well as recalling after a delay of time. So that was the difficulty on the test that we said where they can't reproduce the information. But I loved a student once that I was watching study. And I said to him, what are you doing? And he was doing this. He was just turning every page in the book. And I said, you know, what is that? And he says, oh, I've seen that. I've seen that. I've seen that. I've seen that. And he thought he knew it. I mean, he thought that it was in here because he recognized what he saw on the page. So again, that's something as far as learning efficacy that becomes an issue that stands in the way. Also have slower processing speed, sometimes in the visual, sometimes in the auditory areas. This again affects males greater than females. So it takes them longer to process the information as reproducing the information. So we can see that's going to affect learning as well. These are also all affected by other areas. We know that attention and working memory as a function of learning can affect learning, just as lack of sleep, depression. So there are lots of things going on that will make learning less effective for these students. Attention span is extremely important for learning. You've got to pay attention in order to learn it. Also working memory, you have to code it and process it so it's in there. And if it doesn't get in there, if it kind of stops, you know, goes in here and out the other one, it's true. If it doesn't go up and get processed, You don't have the information later to retrieve. The other thing that's really important that people don't understand is a good perception of time for learning. You need to understand both the passage of time and the concepts of before and after enduring. And we find that students with ADHD particularly have a very poor concept of the passage of time. They don't know how long they've been reading. You may see it if you're a parent and they take the shower for 3 hours. You're wondering if your water heater has run out. And you come and say, why did you take that long shower? And they say, well, I was only in there a couple minutes. You know, the passage of time is something that's difficult for them, which again makes it difficult for planning, for how am I going to fit all this in? What am I going to do? You know, really, they live, and I said it a few minutes ago about if it doesn't need to be done now, it doesn't need to be done. Students with ADHD, which is a one, but they don't understand what comes before and what comes after. So they don't understand the consequences, what they do now, how it affects what's going to happen. I always say they make great Wall Street traders, though. You know, they could have made a lot of money, and they're still now, so that's past. I lost that $1 billion yesterday, you know, and I'm going to start all over again today. It's a good trait in some respect, but it also interferes with the ability to learn, and also learning. As far as learning, we see a lot of times these students, parents will say to me, you know, they really don't learn by cause and effect like other kids do. You know, for the majority of people, if every time you do A, B happens, you can figure out that maybe I don't want to do A. But for them, they don't, again, this time perception connection to learning. They don't learn that this will happen in the future if I do this right now. If I don't study right now, I won't know it when I take the test. If I don't go to class, I won't know the material. Again, so there's a lot of time perception involved in learning that people don't think about. That is an issue for students with ADHD. Also, rapid information processing, and we've talked about that a lot. In the word executive functioning, I want to come back to that right now. What is it? I just say it's the CEO of our brain. It's what helps us organize, strategize, plan ahead, set a program for action of how we're going to get something done, how we're going to work on things. In early childhood, this involves simple responses to really limited demands in a protected environment. Mom and dad at home asking you to do something. Okay? So how are you going to get it done? You know, simple response. I need you to make your bed, or I need you to do this, or whatever. In later childhood and into adulthood, executive functioning matures, areas of the brain mature, and they become more important in what we need to do. What is executive functioning at this higher level? It's really juggling competing demands on our time, or our learning, or our task, or independence, and requires us to organize and plan. So we have to organize, plan in order to juggle these tasks or to be able to function independently. And this is again where the individuals with ADHD have difficulty. We know IQ can mitigate some of the issues for a good period of time. But it was found in studies that were done of high IQ high school students and early college students that they suffered functioning and were only able to function up to a point because they had high IQs. Also, we knew that the impairments that they had didn't interfere with their performance until relatively late in their career, college. So there was enough, we called it scaffolding, there was enough support for these students through high school so that they could function. However, when they got to college, it wasn't there for them in the majority of instances. Also, students report that during the elementary school years, they're able to function and live up to the high expectations because of support that they had from parents and other people. It was not until they themselves had to keep track of all these assignments and had different teachers and had to prioritize and remember that it became apparent. So we can see now, I mean, a lot of people, this has all been an explanation for you. A lot of people say, well, my son or daughter did so well at high school, why are they flunking out of your college? You know, they all are mystified. What's going on here? That's why people say, well, why has this transition to college been so difficult? Why are you even talking about this? My son or daughter got in UNC Chapel Hill. Everything should be okay. Why are they having trouble? And this is why, this background that I've just been giving you about some of these things, both the environment is different and the demands are different. And that makes all the difference. So what are some of the common challenges that we see at college? Aha. Procrastination, meeting deadlines, being late, chronically late. So those are issues. Chronic stress, frequently feeling overwhelmed. Identifying and using existing resources is difficult for these students. They don't know where to go. They don't know what to do. In high school, they were there. They knew. And they were living with their mother and father in most instances. So they had them readily available. Now I have to go find out who's going to help me. Okay, we also see that these students are very disorganized as far as their material space. I have to tell a funny story here, an effort. So they may work really hard and then they don't work for a while. But as far as space is concerned, I want to talk about it a little bit. And you say, well, what? How could that happen? I once had a patient who, we did get him an accommodation for college. He was so distractible and so messy, quite frankly, that we knew he was not going to make it in a dorm room with someone else. You know, there was going to be a lot of turmoil and tribulation in that dorm room between the two of them. So I did get this student an accommodation on a Virginia school campus where he had a private room. And that's no easy feat, okay? Because housing on campus is really tight. They don't have a lot of private rooms. We got him a private room. I was feeling very successful after all the letters I wrote, and he was really went off. He was not in there more than a day, and I got a phone call from him. I went, oh, not good. He says, Dr. Quinn, this room is not going to work. And I said, why? He said, they're building another dorm next door and there's a big hole with lots of equipment right outside my window. He said, I am going to spend, he'd been my patient long enough to know this, I'm going to spend the entire time I'm in my room looking out the window building that building. He says, you have to move me, you have to get me another room. But again, space is, where are you located? Where do you study best? Well, you need to know yourself well enough to do this. But again, this is one of the challenges. You know, now you have to share a room and you have a little space here and a little space here. So if you had that much space when you were at home to spread out all your stuff, now you only got that much space to spread out all your stuff. It's a real executive functioning challenge, believe me. Also what we see is they really make poorly planned choices for assignments, course selections, majors, careers. I'm going to share a personal story here for my son in that he knew that he had a really strong success with discussion. Signed up for a lot of classes that met in the evening that were discussion classes, and he did very well in them. He got all A's in those classes. And as most parents are, right before he was to kind of, you know, count up all those credits for graduation, I said, now are you sure you have enough credits to graduate? And he calls me back and he said, yes, I went to my advisor and I checked and I have enough. And guess what, Mom? I have a minor in theology because of all those discussion classes I took. But again, the students don't usually know where their strengths and weaknesses are, so they sign up for an 8 a.m. class. Why would you ever sign up for an 8 a.m. class on the other side of campus if you had ADHD? So we can see again how this can interfere, the executive function issues for our poor plan choices for some of these are really very important. They also have difficulty with saliency, focusing on what's important versus what's not. And become a great issue where they spend an inordinate amount of time working on something that's not going to matter or make any difference. Oh, I see someone smiling over here. And it's very difficult for someone with these executive function difficulties to be able to sort out what they should be paying attention to at that minute. What is most important? That fly on the wall, the digger outside, or the lecturer in the front of the room? And sometimes it's very difficult. Also, they have difficulty using existing skills and knowledge at the point of performance. So they may know what they're supposed to do, they may have even done it before, but it's the confrontation, being under the gun, being under pressure, that they really can't produce what they know. I know Russell Barkley calls ADHD a production deficit disorder, that they can't produce what's going on. They also don't do a good job at transferring what they know or what they've used in other circumstances. They're kind of stuck and very limited and being able, you know, if you say to them, well, what have you done that's something like this before that you've been successful at? They go, oh. You know, but they can't generate that on their own. They can't take those lessons that they learned over here and apply them over here to this situation. One of the things that we found when we studied parenting of parents with ADHD, of mothers, this was a study of mothers, we found they were not very good at problem solving, and they tended to not be very creative, and they tended, again, to do the same thing over and over and over again, which resulted in failure rather than trying to generate a different solution to the problem. And we see that with students with ADHD, that they have a great deal of difficulty being able to generate and using existing skills to generate a new solution to a problem. They also may have difficulty reading social niceties and social cues. That's, again, a visual attention. You have to pay attention. You know, oh, you had your hair done? Your hair's a different color. You know, that kind of thing. They don't pay attention to those kinds of things that, again, get them into trouble, into difficulties. Okay, so we've talked about lots of problems. Let's try to talk about a few solutions here, because that's what you're here for today. So how can we better prepare students for success at college? The first thing we do is raise awareness in these students, whether they're transitioning, incoming freshmen, or whether they're high school students. We want to prepare them for the stark differences between high school and college. So we want to talk about some of these issues that we've talked about before. Scheduling classes. What do you do in your downtime? When are you going to study? How do you study best? Are study groups good for you? Are discussion classes good for you? Again, we want to talk about the differences, and we want to talk about generating solutions or what's going to work for you when you get to college. But you have to raise the issue. They don't think about fitting themselves into this. They like the environment. They like the campus. They like the name. They like the people they met who took them on tour. They like all of that. You know, they're sold. They want to be here, okay? But they haven't done any of this kind of thinking about how am I going to make it there once I get there. You know, we do a great job selling our college to them, and they're in it. They've signed on. They'll get their banners. They'll get their whatever. They've got their bumper stickers on their car in the back window already. But they haven't thought of any of these things. We need to work with these teens and these college students to say, it's time for you now to stretch and grow and deal with these issues and be responsible and think about the consequences of the decisions you make, to be better at making choices for yourself and to deal with some of these issues yourself. So we need to say, you know, this is on you right now. And challenge them to say, you, and say, I'm here for support, but you can do this. And in order for you to be successful, you need to do this. Because we're not just talking about here in Carolina. We're talking about life. And this is where it starts. When mom and dad get in the car and wave goodbye, that's when their life starts as an independent human being that's got to make it. And they don't understand that. They just want to know which side of the room they got, where's the party tonight, when's the football game on Saturday. And that's what they're thinking about. And, you know, please let them go away and not say anything embarrassing before they leave. And please don't kiss me goodbye. You know, that kind of thing in front of my friends. We also need to think about assessing their readiness for college. You know, just because they've graduated from high school or they're a certain age, are they really ready? So the book that Teresa and I made was really looking about making a readiness plan. What skills do they have? I got a phone call. The reason why that book was generated is I got a phone call from a mother one day and she was crying. I get a lot of those. And she said, my son's going away to college in 5 days. And I'm really worried he's not going to remember to take his medication in the morning on his own, and that he's not going to get up for class. And I said to her, does he get up for class on his own now? And does he take his own medication without you reminding him? No. I said, he's not going to do it in 5 days. So again, sometimes we send our students off to college. Really? We set them up for failure. Do they know how to do their own laundry? Can they manage an ATM or a credit card? You know, when they used to give anybody, they used to on college campuses, remember they had those tables? Just sign up for all those credit cards? I had a student with ADHD after her first semester had $33,000 in credit card debt. She hadn't practiced with money, and they were giving out these credit cards, and she thought, So again, we need to assess how ready are they to be on their own? Have I been spending some time before they got here to help them be able to do these things? And what are we going to do in the instances that we need to help them do that? Again, talking with them, assessing the difference, total freedom and the responsibilities that the total freedom of college allows them. Now you have to be responsible for your decisions. I'm not bailing you out here. What decision? You decide to go throw frisbees on the outside and not study? That's a decision you made. You have to then suffer the consequences of that. There are no adults around that are going to tell you that you cannot do that. Go throw the frisbees. Someone will support you if you ask, but they're not going to say, are you studying right now? Why aren't you in your dorm room? I'm sure you've never said that to a student like that. Why are you right now? We talked about the no homework rule. They've had homework. Guess what? I got here. I don't have homework. I can't go throw that frisbee. No one's coming to me to tell me to go to a resource room. No one's coming to me to tell me to go to the writing center. No one's telling me to go do this and go do that. And then we talked again about the teachers before. What we find, and I wanted to put this up here because I think it's very important. And I think it really underscores why I'm here today. All these skills that we've been talking about are skills that adults with ADHD, or areas that adults with ADHD also have difficulty. And if we don't learn them now, not only are they not going to be successful here or at any other postgraduate institution, they're not going to be successful in life. So what we really want to do with this transition, or before they come to the campus, is help them develop these skills so they can be successful adults with ADHD. And that's the bottom line. We're all here today, that's why we do what we do. Because these are the areas that they really do have to be successful. Strategically, we need to work on non-academic readiness skills. We need to work on other skills that they need in order to be successful in life. Self-determination, daily living skills. We need to help them understand what learning strategies work for them and what doesn't. I'm going to give examples of that for some of my students. If they sign up with a group of students in their class and actually have a study group, they find that, first of all, they show up because that's what makes them peer interaction, makes them show up for the study group. And it's also discussing the information that they're supposed to be either working on or learning is a way that a lot of students with ADHD learn. So if we're all in this group talking about it, I can get this information better. I may need to go to the library by myself. If a student doesn't learn that, they don't get to the library by themselves. So again, we need to start talking and looking at what study skills or what study strategies help me, individual, personally learn better. You know, if I don't get a good night's sleep, I can't do X, Y, or Z. Well, then what do you need to do to get a good night's sleep? You need to go to bed. Okay. So we need to kind of work some of the issues before they get here. I mean, we all take these for granted, and yet, because they're so basic, and yet these are the areas that students with ADHD have difficulty with. Going to bed at night. Can you remember dragging your three-year-old to bed? Well, at 23, he's still having difficulty dragging himself to bed. At 33. So we need to say, how do you do that? How do I get to be able to do that? And they're necessary. Also, slowly fading reliance on accommodations that may not be available at the college level. Because a lot of times these students have really gotten into an enabled situation where no matter what happens, this is what you're going to do, and we're going to give you, and we're going to help you, and we're going to offer you. And that may not be something that happens on campus unless they themselves seek it out or they themselves set a little bit more on the college than it is before. Also, and this is a big one, I'm going to talk about it a lot today, practicing good decision-making, problem-solving. Because this is, again, an area that I found that students with ADHD, because of their deficits, have difficulty with. And they really get into a lot of trouble both academically and socially because of this. Also, they need to work on other issues. And by that, I mean drug addiction, depression, suicidal ideations, other problems that may have come up in their adolescent years before they get there. And they really need to be addressed and to have a program set up before they get there. I'm going to give you another example. There was a girl that I worked with who I had just met her about 6 months before she had to go off to college. I diagnosed her with ADHD. I had depression. So in D.C., off to a college in Boston. And I made sure that she had the name of a psychiatrist in Boston when she left that she could see when she got up there. Again, taking care of some other issues that I felt this girl had, that she was prone to depression, and it probably was going to be an issue for her when she got to college. I didn't see her again until Thanksgiving break in November. And she came to see me briefly while she was home. And she was sitting there, and she had long sleeves on. And people with ADHD, I'm sure you already can tell, I'm self-disclosing, I have ADHD, have really, really good intuition sometimes that are going on. And I just said to her, would you mind rolling up your sleeves? And she did, and she was cutting. And at that point I asked her, and we've done studies now showing that girls and women with ADHD have a lot of self-injurious behavior. And suicidal attempts as well. And I asked her why she was cutting at that point. And she had been date raped and didn't know what to do about it. And as a result, she was now cutting. Now, this is someone who went off to college on a campus that I'm sure had a center, crisis center, that she should go to. She had the phone number that I gave her of a psychiatrist that was in Boston that she could go see. And yet, even though we had tried, these other issues will come up, and these students, this was a bright girl who had all that information, who did not know how to deal with the situation at all. So I think that that's, again, another important thing we have to think about before they go. What is available as far as support and scaffolding and structure nets that they have available where they're going? I saw this recently, and I apologize for the slide, but it was so great, I had to show you the picture. It says, stop. If you are dropping off your son's forgotten lunch, books, homework, equipment, etc., please turn around and exit the building. Your son will learn to problem solve in your absence. This is, again, the issue we see for a lot of the students when they get to campus. They don't know how to problem solve because they haven't had to problem solve. This is a skill that's difficult for people with ADHD that they need to practice a lot. And we don't give them the opportunity to practice. We don't even teach them how to do it. Okay, and for those who want me to teach you how to do it, here's a little graphic on how you problem solve. First of all, you need to identify there's a problem. Then, and this is something that students with ADHD are usually very good at, this next step, number two. Look at creative ways to solve this problem. And they can probably generate a lot. So one, they might not be so good at. Two, they're really good at once you identify the problem. So you just throw out there some, well, you know, how do you think we can solve this? But then we get to selecting the best alternative. Might not be so good at that. Then what do we do is we test it out. We implement it, see if it works. Did it work? Great if it did. If it didn't work, we got to go back over here and try again and get one of those alternative solutions that we might work. But again, if you have people telling you what the solution is, if you have people not letting you fail or try and fail, you don't even know what this loop is all about. And these, the people who can do this, are the people who are successful in life. I'm sure you go out there and talk to a lot of people who are successful businessmen. Their first idea didn't work. Maybe their second didn't. Maybe their third didn't. Look at, we got Trump wine, we got Trump da-da, you know, it didn't all work. So, you know, they just keep trying. Another idea to see what works. What are some strategies we can use with our children or executive function? One of the things is to reduce memory load, so keeping it up here. An example from the audience, what can you do so I don't have to keep it up here? What do? How can I reduce my memory load? Write it down, make lists. Dictate into your little phone. Call yourself up. Leave a message. Okay? So you need to reduce the amount of stuff you need to remember. Or you need to set up reminders. You know, I used to love using the computer with my students that says, are you doing what you, every once in a while would have this little thing automatically pop up and says, are you doing what you're supposed to be doing right now? Especially on the computer. So you set up these little reminders. Also work in small groups. So you're not going to get this all done today. It's actually probably better if you don't try to get it all done today. So how are you going to set this up so we can break it down and work it a little bit every day? Provide scaffolding of the visual clues. I had a call once from one of my patients, and he said, Dr. Quinn, I found a cure for my ADHD. I said, you have? He said, yes. What? Post-it notes. Roommate was a little alarmed because there were just post-it notes everywhere. But again, providing yourself visual cues to help you say, oh, this is what I need to be doing now, or this is where it needs to be, or where is, or you know, where you're going to be. And the more unconventional or the more striking they are, the better it will be. For remembering or doing them. For those of you who are always losing your keys, maybe it's a good idea to always keep your keys in the freezer. I don't know. But I'll sure remember if I put my keys in the freezer all the time. There's some things, oh, where? Oh yeah, freezer. Okay. Checklists are important. So that you can see what have I done, what do I need to do, kind of assess for the management issues as well, which we'll talk about. This is the really big one here. Because the coach can really help them work in all these other areas, to help them set up these checks and balances, to help them break things down into smaller chunks, to help them be responsible in more, to help them generate solutions, to help them look at, help them identify what the problem is, and to help them to generate those solutions and work in those areas. So again, a lot of this we really can work on. Work on it and have a system of how are we going to work on it and what are we going to do to make them successful. It is not going to happen by waving goodbye and wishing. If it's all right with all of you, I wanted to say a couple more things, but I'd like to stop for the break early because I told Teresa when I came in here I was very nervous that I had more stuff I wanted to talk about in the second half than I did in the first. I really just wanted to lay out the problem in the first half and talk about general solutions. The real meat of this talk is in the second hour, so you can't go. You gotta come back. But if we can stop now and have our break now, it would be fantastic because I really want to be able to deal with this more specifically. The last thing I wanna say just this morning before we close and go on this break is, one of the things that I think is very important that Teresa and I, and again our other book, have talked about is I talked a little bit about it, but I didn't come out quite as strongly as I wanted to, is to talk about the issue of enabling or really working with our students in a way. It was a little bit in the problem-solving areas. But when we talk about it, what we really want to do is adopt a more coaching model when we work with our students, whether it's as a tutor, as an advisor, as a parent. We really want to be able to say the student has the answers to their problems. They probably don't think they do, but they do. And what we want to be able to do, instead of telling them what to do, or enabling them because we're setting all this up for them. What we want to do is to be able to work with them in a coaching model of to be able to help them set goals, be able to know how to reach those goals, and to have some accountability in their lives. And our book, the books that aren't here today, deal with those issues of how do you see what skills your student is deficient in, where do they need to be strengthened, and then how do you set up a program to work with them as a parent or teacher or school advisor, school counselor, or a coach, in a way that allows them to be able to develop these skills and have these skills before they transition to college. So that you can actually take, how many weeks do we have before we go off to college? And we got 5 weeks and we got 5 weeks. You better work on a skill a week to help them be more ready. Now, if you have 5 years to work on them, it's much better than 5 weeks. But I think that this is, again, a way, I wanted to close this morning with this kind of framework, that what we really want to do is switch from a role of rescuer, enabler, director, that's another one. Everyone likes to direct who's going to do what when. But switch from those roles, telling people what to do, to really working as a coach in cooperation and with the student to practice and gain the skills that they need to be successful. You're refreshed. You've had something to eat, a break. All right, now we're going to get down to work. Okay, here they go every year, off to college, pack up, drive up on campus, discharge everyone from the car, all the belongings, all the everything. But we want to make sure they stay there. I want them to come back. So this is the passport part. We're giving out passports right now so that they don't come back. What is the passport for success? Transition to college. The first thing is self-knowledge. I always say, if my patient is not standing up by eighth grade and saying, I have ADHD, I'm an okay person, I'm not defined by my ADHD, it's just something I happen to have. Strengths, do well, here's what I can do for you in this class, at home, on the team. Here's how I can contribute, but here are the areas that I need help in, and here's how you can help me. Eighth grade. I sometimes have them younger than that doing that. Because if you have a 16, 17, 18-year-old who's arguing with you about whether or not he or she has ADHD, we have a real problem still. We need to what the problem is. And not only the problem, we need to recognize strengths. Who am I? What am I good at? Where do I get in trouble? Where do I excel? Where do I need help? Where do I need build skills? What do I need to do differently? How do I study? How do I learn? What are subjects. Everyone doesn't have to get an A in everything, you know. I live in the only area, well no, there are a few others, where having an average IQ is the worst diagnosis I can give to a parent. Your child's average. Oh my God, what are we going to do? So self-knowledge is the most important thing. Self-advocacy. I need to be able to go up and talk to that professor proactively ahead of time, but I need to be able to go up and ask somebody for help. I need to be able to call you. I remember my daughter calling me once from a house, but they were getting dressed before a party and said, Mom, you need to come get me. I said, why? She said, because they're all already drinking and I need to come home. Okay, how do you get the help you need? What do? How do you get out of situations? How do you not get in situations? How do you ask? This is an important point. I always say ADHD, or acknowledging that you have ADHD, is an explanation of what's going on. It is not an excuse for you out of anything that you need to do. including growing up. For ADHD is an explanation, not an excuse. But we need to be able to know then how to advocate for ourselves in a positive way, not saying, oh, I can't do that with ADHD. Or not, you need, you know, ADA, my IEP says this, you need to do this for me. So we need to know how to self-advocate. Again, very important skill. These two skills, if a student or a child or an adult has self-knowledge and self-advocacy, we know they are going to be successful despite whatever diagnosis they may have. To go any further than this in most instances. Because this is what you need. This is to be stamped on your passport if you're going to be successful. So you have self-knowledge, you got it. Do I have self-advocacy skills? I got them. Okay. I have to be able to learn how I plan for things that are going to come in the future. Remember that time, that dealing with time, not living in the now? Well, if you live in the now, you don't have to plan. You just do whatever comes along. But I need to develop the ability to plan, to strategize, to say, how am I, here's the idea I have, how am I going to make it happen? How am I from here to there? And that's a skill that, again, we need to work on. We need to talk about. We need to develop. Remember, students with ADHD, that's why I did the first half of the talk, they don't know how to do this. Then we need to learn about self-care. And again, a lot of students with ADHD or adults, people with ADHD, don't know how to do this. They don't know how to take good care of themselves. We're talking about exercising, sleeping, eating. We're talking about learning to say no. Or I can't do that. Maybe later. Or ask me again. Or let me think about it. But I think this is, again, an issue. These are extremely important for success. I haven't actually put on here that you're good in calculus. Or you can, you know, program any computer. These are the skills that are going to make you successful if you have ADHD. We want to have someone, again, I hope this slide conveyed it. We want to have someone that knows himself, takes good care of himself, that can reflect, identify, strategize, and set out on a program for success. And most of the students we see are not anywhere near this level when we see them, for many reasons. I think that it's important. This quote from the study we did, Teresa. Remember the kid in the candy store? For many students, when they come to college, again, I said they like the campus, they like what's going on, but they look around and they go, wow, you know, look at all the things I can do here. And none of them can, you can do a lot of things that don't even have anything to do with studying. Join this group, join that group, what am I going to do? But it's important to help and assess whether the student we're sending off to college is approaching it like a kid in a candy store, or whether they really have tried to develop a program for success that utilizes and builds on their skills, strengths, and helps them make accommodations for their weaker areas. This is, again, what we need. We need to assess the strengths and weaknesses. We need to set up a program to help them with accommodations and skills that they don't have that will, so they can be successful when they get to campus. And I think that this, again, is important. I'm not talking to you out there, unless you're a student. Raise your hand, the students, okay? You, the student, is responsible for making this success happen. They need to gain the knowledge about their disorder. They need to gain knowledge about their treatment. I so often say, you know, and I said this to the students that I'm wonderful, great students. All meet them. They were fantastic students this morning. I said to them, how many of you, remember there were about between 25 and 30 in the room, and I said, how many of you had, when you got a diagnosis or had testing, how many of you had someone explain the results of that testing to you? To you, not to your parents. Only one raised their hand. Again, we don't make them part of the problem. So often, you know, when you step foot on campus, your mother and father probably know more about your ADHD and your learning strengths and weaknesses than you do. That's not a good passport for success. So again, we need the student real early on take responsibility for making the success happen by learning self-advocacy, learning about their disorder. Learning how to take care of themselves. Why is a late diagnosis so common? Well, reasons. One, the student with an IQ mitigates ADHD diagnosis. You can get by on your smarts for a really long time. And you can use the pressure of being under the gun and write that paper the night before and get a B. For a long time. And two, well-meaning parents and educators enable the students so that they are successful and don't have to develop these skills. So the reason why we don't find out that they have the issue until they get to the college or attempt to live on their own. And that's when we find out that they don't have the skills necessary for that. So we see why the late diagnosis is common. Usually they're very bright. Secondly, they've been enabled. Now, studies have shown that being enabled and having a lot of support in high school does have good prognosis too, because you know, you've been able to get this far. But at this point, you need to learn the skills. We would like you to learn them before, but at this point, you need to learn the skills. Medication treatment may be complicated with anxiety, depression, and other issues for a long time. I know, particularly gender issues for girls and women, girls are very often diagnosed as anxious and depressed. Those are really easy symptoms to see. And they know how to treat them. So we treat the depression, we treat the anxiety, and no one thinks this girl might possibly have ADHD. So she's not diagnosed at that point. And she's bright, and she's gotten good grades, and you know she's a little depressed. But you really have, again, enabled her and supported her to get through high school. So that this is a real issue. And as I said before, often, for those who take medication in high school, they think that they can go off to college and start without it. Well, I saw a psychiatrist all through high school, but I'm not going to see one when I go off to college. So again, these are issues in these plays that make a difference here. It answers the question for us, why are they now failing, which is the question most parents come up. It's essential that we start developing early, but we need them by the time we get to college. If we're going to have success or a passport for success, developing habits and structures and patterns of living that, you know, a habit makes it much easier. You know, you brush your teeth every night before you go to bed. Well, you know, I may need to remind you when you're 7, hopefully not when you're 17, but if you have that as a habit, when you go to college, we hope you brush your teeth. If not, someone will probably tell you along the way about the problem. That's the same thing we want with some of these other issues, that we want to develop habits. We want to develop patterns. We want to develop programs that you use that have been successful, that you say, this is what I need. I'm going to have to find and set this up here in order for me to be successful here. Remember I said this morning that it's sometimes very hard for people with ADHD to take what happened over here and bring it over here and use it in this situation as well. So this is, again, something that we need to have happen for them to be successful, that they've set up these habits, that they've gotten used to doing certain of these things, that they've developed certain skills. Again, often to be successful at college, we have found that coaching provides an essential life to being able to deal with this transition period. That the coach, not through enabling, but through coaching, allows the student, through asking questions and having them find the solution, goals and become accountable for those goals, develop some of these patterns and structures and programs that they need. So often, again, the coach is extremely important. I wish that every student could have a coach on campus, no matter where they are, whether or not they have ADHD. And I know on this campus, coaches are available to every student who needs one. It's not everywhere, but here it is. And this is why we say that we really need them during the transition period. Successful, because the majority of these students do not have these skills. Self-advocacy skills are critical. I talked about that on my Passport for Success. And most students, again, don't have these. Or if they have them, they don't understand how to use them. One of the things, I think it's going to be my last sentence in the talk this afternoon, is talking about being proactive. I see a lot of students who want to make sure, when they go with their parents to visit these schools and to visit the programs, the learning centers, etc., they want to know who is going to send the letter to all the professors about their problem. That's their big concern. Who is going to send those letters out? And how are you going to make sure they get those letters? And how are you going to enforce that the professor has to do what this letter says? That's their most important concern. My most important concern, and I posit to you that this is the better way to look at it, is I want the student to proactively say, I am going to go talk to my professor when I get on campus before the classes start, or the first day of class, or the first office hours. And I'm going to go into that professor and I'm going to say, hello, Dr. So-and-so, my name's Patricia, and I have ADHD, and I really want to do well in your class. And I have been very successful in high school. I handed my paper professor a week ahead of time and let them look at it. Would you be willing to do that for me? Well, I don't think they'd be working here if they said no. But you see the difference between a family and a student who is looking for someone to send that letter out and make sure all the professors get that letter, and someone who understands what they need for their success and are willing to proactively go and self-advocate for it. And that's the difference between success and failure in the majority of these cases. Because again, in the first case, the student is still relying on you to go to this other person, and then you enforce that this other person do this. And it's not a passport for success. People forget about this, but there are two words in here, under and over commitment. We see so many students who have ADHD when they get here, I talked about kid in the candy store, either overcommit to everything going on or isolate and undercommit because they know how hard they had to work in high school and how many hours they had to stay up, and they just can't, they know that they can't get it all done or do anything, so they isolate. I mean, we talked to many students this morning who said all they did in high school was just work. They didn't have any fun. I'm not saying you shouldn't have fun at college. These are probably the 4 years you're going to have the most fun in your life, okay? But what I see are so many students undercommitting as a result of what their life has been like and how they know. So we need to help them, again, understand and look, learn about their disability and what treatment they need and what programs they need so that they don't have to work 20 hours out of every 24 hours in order to keep up academically. And many of them do work 20 out of 24 hours to keep up academically and have to do work on the weekends, et cetera. So again, we want to make sure we address both of these if they're going to be successful at college. Success is not only measured by the grade, your grade point average. And again, these are important considerations for when you have ADD in college. Okay, let's talk a little bit about differences in academic coping strategies that we see. We know that ADHD is probably very equally divided by this level, so the gender representation is usually about 1-to-1. Before, it's about 2.5 males to every female. But when we get to over 20-year-olds, we see equal representation with between the genders with ADHD. Well, now I guess it's among, I don't know. Seek support and experience greater levels of social support than men. That's another issue we need to be reminded of at college. So women are a little bit better at asking for help at the college level. So we need to make it okay, and some of our outreach also needs to be for the men with ADHD. However, women reported having significantly more time management issues. And when you talk, when I was just talking about the overcommitment and working very hard, we find that it's the women who tend to work 20 out of 24 hours. They, I was talking about this morning, we find that women with ADHD tend to develop either perfectionism or obsessive compulsive personality disorders, where they actually work very hard to keep up and to stay with, where the guys would be the ones who would go out and shoot baskets and play with the frisbee, football, and whatever else they're doing, and just say, you know, the heck with it, I'm, you know, procrastinate, and I'm not gonna do that right now. What we find is that the females tend to be the ones who continue to stay up and to work very, very hard, and that they have a lot more difficulty with time management issues and planning and strategizing and getting everything done. Said men tend to procrastinate and not work on these things right now, and just kind of like out of sight, out of mind. I don't need to think about that right now. I can go do something else. Again, as you know, I don't need to go over this in detail, but I just want to talk about that students who have received help in high school, the majority of them tend to not go and seek help when they get on the college campuses as well. So many don't access the support, even if they had it in high school. So that the students did not use the available resources on campus. And that's something, again, we want to support as parents and before they leave, the advisors, et cetera, who see these students. We want to be able to say, well, you had those services before. Why don't you go see so-and-so on campus? We have a learning center here, we have a writing center. Maybe it would be a good idea if you checked into one of those and see what that's all about. I think this is another important point to make when we're dealing with students, whether it's our child or our student in school, particularly in high school. And I don't think they really get this right away. But if you plan to learn anything, you need to learn to plan. And remember the first half, the first session, I spent a lot of time talking about the fact that individuals with ADHD have a great deal of difficulty planning. How to make a plan so they can learn, we again need to make referrals. We need to make sure that they understand there are supports on campuses, that the coaching services, the learning center, for writing, the Writing Center, that will help them create plans so they can learn. Because this is, again, an area, learning to plan, is a skill that they need that they don't have when they get here. End up having academic difficulty. Some other issues that must be addressed, self-care. Particularly, I find, again, eating, exercise, and sleeping. You know, they need to know how to do their laundry, too, but and manage money. But these, sleeping, eating, and what was the other one? Exercise, need to be written into their overall plans. When are you going to exercise? When are you going to sleep? Hello? When are you going to go to bed? Are you going to go to This is really critical because is affected by lack of sleep. All we need is one night of sleep deprivation to affect our attention span. If you already have a trouble with attention span and you start doing getting sleep deprived, it's going to make your problems worse. And I always say, I love, it starts in high school. We say to my students, you know, when you stay up until 2 and 3 in the morning and then sleep till noon or 1 or 2 on Saturdays and Sundays, that's like taking a trip to California and back every weekend. You don't feel really good when you do that. If I said to you, you have to fly out to California every Friday and take the red eye back Sunday night, you'd say, gosh, you know, I'm going to feel terrible Monday morning. Well, guess what? You do what I just said on campus every weekend and you feel terrible Monday morning. It's another issue of self-care that's really important. Time management, we've talked about a lot. Very important. How are you going to manage my time? For Tuesdays and Thursdays, or you set up a schedule so you have a Friday off. For people with ADHD, in addition to living in the now, the other thing that they're really, really good at is if I have lots of things to do, I'll get them all done. If I have nothing to do, I'll get nothing done. So you need to set up a schedule. Oh gosh, this really ticks them off. You need to set up a schedule. What are you going to do on those days that you don't have classes? And I really, really like getting a part-time job. I don't know any college student who doesn't have problems that need help with money, and they can use a little extra money from them. But it also makes them develop a schedule, and around we can work in working on the paper, getting the reading assignment done that you need to do. That's much better than going to play cards all day with somebody. So you need to kind of assess that issue and realign their thinking about how they need to schedule every day. And if you do need to go to the library, how are you going to get there? Not physically, mentally. How are you going to get to the library? Are you going to have somebody come pick you up, say, I'm going to the library, let's go together? That works. Or I'll do this for so long, I'll go play with my buddies. I always knew I made it with my son when one day when I brought him back to school, instead of dropping him off at his apartment, he said to me, Mom, would you drop me at the Writing Center because I won't get... Again, so those are the kinds of things we need to set up as far as managing. To develop strategies and routines, like I said, have your computer pop up and say, are you doing what you're supposed to be doing right now? You know, like, where is your dog? Where are your keys? Have you exercised today? You know, whatever it is. But we need to start using technology. Our phones can do anything. And we need to start using technology to help us develop these routines and structures for us. We also need to look at anxiety and depression, very students on campus, because they will interfere with success. They may need to be treated in addition to ADHD. And if we don't address these issues, I mean, I've had many students who were very informed about their ADHD, but became severely depressed and could not function at all when they first got to campus. And that needs to be addressed. Also know that often, particularly in females with ADHD, we have a significant associated problem with eating disorders for females with ADHD. And we often find that these eating disorders are exacerbated or intensified when they make the transition to college. So that may be another issue that needs to be looked at or addressed for a successful transition. And then again, substance abuse and high-risk behaviors may need to be addressed as well in these students. So I think there's a lot of things to think about here, not only academics, if we want to make a successful transition. If your student has had problems with substance abuse or addiction previously, that needs to be addressed before they go on campus. I had a student in high school as a patient of mine that had significant problems with substance addiction, and he signed himself into one of the local inpatient facilities. Did at the University of Pennsylvania. This was at the end of his senior year. There was no way I, as his treating physician, when he got out of the inpatient facility, wanted him to go off to the University of Pennsylvania campus. He wrote them a letter after his acceptance and asked to defer and come a year later. And he went into an Outward Bound program for a year and then was very successful at the University of Pennsylvania when he finally went. But again, for parents whose students have had problems, you don't just send them off to college if you want them to be successful. These problems need to be addressed. Okay, these are again some suggestions that we have found, accommodations that have worked, that are very helpful for students, set up these routines on college campuses to get them to be able to be responsible for times. Setting up study groups is really important for several of the reasons I said before. It gets the student someplace on time. They can discuss the work with other students. It gives them some responsibility and some. So meeting in a study group in the library is often very successful for these students with their class. Already talked about this. No days off. More scheduled, the more you get done. Again, very important. 8 a.m. classes. Do you start at 8? Do you have 8 a.m. classes here? Why? Why? Okay. ADHD, but some people may like to be up in the morning. Again, this is where self-knowledge comes in. If you know that an 8 a.m. class, I mean, it gets cold here in the winter, a little bit, okay? You know, are you going to get up and out of bed and class at 8 o'clock in the morning when it's snowing out? Honestly, how many are getting out of bed and going? Discussion classes are usually better. And evening discussion classes for some students are the best. That's where they get their highest grades. Again, but this involves self-knowledge and planning ahead when you're scheduling. Advisor or coach, very important for success. And to work with both of them for some of the scheduling and selecting your major, etc. Disability services on campus. Here it's through your learning center. What do you have on campus?
Accessibility resources.
They all have different names. They all have different names. But again, knowing who they are, this is where the documentation for your campus. Healthy habits, we didn't talk about those a second. And use technology. You know, all these students are excellent with technology. They need to start using it for themselves to ensure success. In high school, most likely it was their mother. Now they can use their smartphone. You know, a lot of times I used to fight with seventh grade teachers. Oh, because somewhere around middle school, the teachers start saying, well, they have to be able to write their homework themselves, and they have to be able to read from books. And I'm going, wait a minute, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, that's not what we're going to be doing, and they may never be doing it, okay? So I think we need to start, you know, dictating into the little phone is really good. Why do I need to copy my homework from the board? For seventh graders. So the use of technology is important, and I'm sure that you can think of many more creative ways than I can to use technology to help these students deal with it. But I think it's very important for success to set up ways to do this. And then be proactive. I talked about that a lot today, but I think it's very important to understand, and again, you need the self-knowledge first to understand, there are going to be areas and places and times and classes where you are going to have difficulty and you are going to have to advocate for yourself. Be proactive. Don't just hope everything is going to get better or go away or everything's going to be fine in this class. You need to be able to say, okay, what do I need to do beforehand to ensure that I have a successful completion of this course or this year or graduation from college? And what do I need? Some not so good news is the emotional aspect. Know that very often in freshman years, a lot of the students struggle emotionally at college for the first time. Freshmen report a lot of problems with depression, and it's very important that we kind of look for this and deal with it and deal with some of the feelings that the college students have of being overwhelmed by all this. And again, particularly for those students who were enabled previously, they are even more overwhelmed on campuses because they've never had to do this for themselves before. So in addition to the usual emotional distress of being away from home and friends and friendly routines and all of that, some students can negotiate that just fine. Others have time with it. Just the normal transition to independent living here on campus. But for students with ADHD, we see that often combined with, I really don't know what to do. And I see a lot of students just almost paralyzed. You know, they're just so overwhelmed by this. They don't know what to do. And we need to give them some place to go. We need to be aware of that. We also need to be aware of help the student themselves be aware of what they need to do to prevent this from happening, that they are going to need help and that they are going to need to find and set up ahead of time, proactive, set up ahead of time a program for success on campus. Okay, someone talked to me briefly at the break. Okay, so what do? I mean, you don't just wave your parents goodbye. They're still probably playing. What do you do? How do you negotiate a contract with working with your friends who are on college campuses? I mean, do you want to just not call them for you know, how many months? I don't think that's going to work out. But, you know, what do you do? What's the balance? How do you work this out? So what you need, again, before you leave, you need to talk to them about how involved you want them to be. I know a woman who actually got a local phone book so she could, you know, call a limo for his son to get him to the airport so he could come home for Thanksgiving. And, yeah, I mean, we're talking about enmeshed here, not just enabling. So you need to have an adult conversation with your parents about how involved you want them to be in this process on campus. Is your mother going to keep calling you up and say, what grade are you getting? How are you doing? Did you write the paper? Send it to me and I'll edit it and type it. Not supposed to do that. Okay? So how involved do you need to be? It's really helpful to establish regular check-ins because, you know, they want to know what's going on. So if you set the groundwork with them about, I will call you every, sometime you agreed on, every Sunday afternoon I'll call you at 4 o'clock, that's useful for both of you. Your mother's not always calling you and saying, and did you get the paper written? Where are you? I tried you last night and you weren't in your dorm room. Okay, so establish regular check-ins. Set up guidelines for the calls, what we will and will not be talking about on the calls. I think at this level, you have to start out again differently than before. It's really important to do some of this again before you go away, instead of trying to make it all up afterwards, after it's happened. And I think that that's really, again, how the relationship has been building and why we tried, in the books Teresa and I have advocated, to this happen. And this has all been set up and worked out, again, before they get to college. But again, setting some guidelines about what you're going to be doing. And this is, again, I'm not saying this to hide things from parents or to help you separate from your parents, but what you want to do is to build a mutually respectful relationship at this time when you're away. I think it's important. They probably know more about your ADHD than you do. They've lived with you and observed it for many years. They know your strengths and weaknesses. They know where you might be going to get trapped or have a problem. So I think it's, again, important to use them as a resource for what do you think I should do? This is what I'm doing and it doesn't seem to be working. Talk over them situations that you might have forgotten about that happened in the past where they can tell you they were successful or you were successful by doing it this way. Again, I don't mean this to be a negative interaction. I really mean it to be positive, where they can say, you know, when you had this problem before, we did this, or you did this, or the teacher did this, and it worked. Maybe you can find someone on campus who can do that for you now. Again, a positive way of interacting, but again, not enabling. Once, who was coming to see me because their grades were so mediocre. They wanted to get in a very famous law school. And their grades at their very prestigious university were kind of mediocre. And they came to me at that point. Now, this young man had a brother who was severely learning disabled and a sister who had ADHD and learning disabilities. He had had no services through high school or through college. And he had an okay GPA, nothing. I mean, he didn't flunk out. So I said, because when I tested him, he had LD and ADHD, and I said, you know, I'm just curious about how you made it. His mother did go to the college campus every week and did his laundry and typed his papers and helped him organize for what he needed to do for the next week and took him shopping for food and he was graduating. I will not tell you the university. But he was graduating from a very prestigious university and was thinking about going on to law school. Okay. It's very important that the student in high school take responsibility for health and their medication if they're on medication. When I bring that up, people are aghast. Do you call and get your refill for your prescription? I say, do you call and make your hair appointment? Or your manager? I say, yeah, I call up to get my hair cut. Do you call the pharmacy? You know how to use the phone? Okay. Very important. I used to, and I had a handout today, I used to see college students and I'd ask them, you see them, I don't know, it's kind of a blue pill, I don't know the name of it. Okay. you can start this, make your doctor appointments. Because when you get on campus, you are going to, when you get appendicitis, you are going to have to find out who you go see. You are going to have to set up ahead of time, how do I get my prescriptions filled here? It is illegal for your mother to have the prescription filled in Minnesota and ship it across state lines to North Carolina. That's a controlled substance going across state lines in the mail. Hello? So you don't call home and say, Mom, I need my prescription refilled. You learn, how do I get my prescription refilled on campus? And who do I see if I have a side effect? Or who do I see if I need an increase in medication? You don't call the doctor back home. You find someone on campus who can do that for you. Or that you can just every once in a while if you are questioning what's going on with your medication. Let them know what you're doing, where you're going to be, okay? And again, I'm not setting this up I'm helping with the separation and this contract that you're going to be dealing with. You know, again, when she calls them and say, well, I called last night and you weren't there. You don't need to tell them everything. Just a general idea. It's very important to discuss financial responsibilities before you go. How much money you're going to have a month, how much you can withdraw. This credit card you can spend as much as you want on. Maybe you think they said that, but did they really say that? Are there limits as to how much I can spend on a credit card? Remember I told you about that very impulsive girl who got all these credit cards? She had never discussed finances with her parents, I'm sure. And she had a $33,000 debt in January already, impulsively spending, because that's what you do with credit cards. And she had ADHD. Financial responsibilities, what they expect you to cover, what you will cover, who's paying for the trip on spring break to Cancun. And try to see it their way. And again, this is from the student's perspective. They have been responsible for you for a it's not going to be easy for them to give up brain. You appreciate what they have done for you because you are here because of what they have done for you, but you really would like to negotiate a different contract right now of how you can be successful while you're here. Okay, that was for the students dealing with their parents. Now, the parents working with their students. How much do you want to keep in touch? You may say, ooh, I don't have to stay up all night and do homework anymore. Remember, I remember you deal with these mothers, you know, when my kids would come, I said, yeah, I've already done seventh grade homework. I don't want to do that anymore. I remember going to the first grade teacher of my for the spell, all three of my children had the same nun for spelling in first grade. And I said, could you please kind of change around the spelling words. Let's not do the colors first, and then, let's change it around a little bit. How much do they want to keep in touch with your student? What do you do when they say send money? Okay, establish this ahead of time, because they may really be in trouble right now, and you want to have had this discussion before, you know, you have to bail them out, literally. Set this up ahead of time. You're going to send money. What are you going to do when they call up and say they hate their roommate or their roommate's blah, 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 blah. What are you going to do? Again, talk about this ahead of time. Talk about how they can solve some of the issues. What are you struggling academically? How are you going to deal with that? Discuss it ahead of time. Okay, what is your plan? 4 or 5 or 6 years? How much will you fund? What are your expectations? I always say, if your student has ADHD, plan for 5 years, and if they do it in 4, take a cruise. Or 4 cruises. Several cruises. Discuss giving college permission to share grades and contact with you. Do that before you go with your student. Because you know, it's a whole different issue that most people aren't aware of. You know, they feel they can pick up the phone anytime and call out anybody for what's going on. So again, it's an important to discuss ahead of time. Okay. Good news. If students access support, their graduation rates are the same as non-disabled peers. And so we need to get them to find help on campus. Where do they find help for emotional problems? Counseling centers, staff in the dorms, university health centers, mental health providers, clergy, campus chaplains, etc. Discuss this again ahead of time. Where do you find help on campus if you're having emotional problems? Where do you find help on campus with academic problems? Proactively visit your professor before office. Not when you're failing, before you're failing. Academic advisors, tutoring programs, mentors, coaching, serious problems, I don't know what it's called here, dean of students, whatever. Go talk to people before they send you the letter. What do they send, letters or emails? I don't know. Probably an email. You are failing. Whoops. Talk to them first. Connect with other people on campus. There are lots of things to deal with adjustment issues on campus. ADHD coaching. Again, it's important for parents and students to understand, how does coaching work? How do I find a coach on campus? Can I set goals with my coach? What do I need to do? Adding structure and achieving balance. So again, coaching is what really helps these students deal with a lot of the issues we've been talking about today, and is important for success on campus. What are some of the academic accommodation issues that you need to address beforehand? And again, documentation and recent assessments. You know, if you were last assessed when you were in sixth grade, that kind of doesn't even tell you your strengths. The type of accommodations that have worked for you in the past. You know, how many people read those books, photocopy, or tear out those lists from the book and say, this is what I want my student to have? Well, we don't know if any of those will work for your student. Self-knowledge, remember, students need to know what accommodations work for them. Recording, everyone says recording lectures. Well, if I can't pay attention for the 3 hours the lecture was given the first time, I am not going to record it and go listen. I've now wasted 6 hours. I am not going to listen to a 3-hour recording of a lecture. Now, if you want to do it because you got up and left a few times because you needed to as an accommodation, you couldn't sit for 3 hours, you can then fill in what the professor said while you were gone on your little breaks. But that's not a good accommodation or an effective accommodation for people with ADHD. What type of accommodation you are going to need? And how has ADHD contributed to your academic issues? We talked before about short-term memory, planning, strategizing, recall. How has ADHD affected your capacity to learn? Very important. Okay? What if you didn't have accommodations in high school? Well, here, you don't have documentation to be able to walk into the learning center. So if you didn't find out you have ADHD or you need a comment, you can get help on campus. Really, really, and that's a luxury not available on a lot of campuses. I don't know really too many others. Again, your professors. You all know who I think should tell your professors. The student, you. I feel you should be responsible, professors, about what's going on. Again, very important ahead of time, if graduation requirements are waived, but can be waived, like a foreign language requirement, math requirement, or your university has or does not have. Most of them won't waive credits required for graduation, but there are some others that you can work on. Should I speak directly with my professor about need? Yes. Even if they send out the letters, you should introduce yourself to your professor at their office hours, and you should talk to them about what you need and what has worked for you in the past and how you want to be successful in their program. Can they apply for early registration? In most instances, yes, and that's very helpful to avoid those 8 o'clock classes. And I must confess, I have put a little bug in the ear of some of the students here that I actually worked with a university where we had an ADHD support group where the students rated all the professors whether or not they were ADHD friendly or not. So you could choose which people were more ADHD friendly than then you can choose the ADHD. Okay, other useful accommodations. Extended time in most instances is helpful for students with ADHD because often they're not organized enough or they may get distracted during the test and be, you know, daydream, oh, I got to come back and answer the next question. Time is somewhat useful. Note takers, I really am plus or minus on that. For a lot of students, they're very useful. For some students, they aren't. A lot of students use the pens that record, which are some taking notes. I think the most important things for notes is we need to teach students with ADHD how to take notes. They don't have that skill. Something that I think is more important than note takers. Useful for students. Now, what is a sanctioned movement break? A lot of students with ADHD have difficulty sitting for long periods of time. You might be able to stay in the chair, but it might be better if you stand in the back. It might be better if you fidget while you're sitting there, or sometimes you even need to take breaks. And I, again, think it's important to proactively go in. As Teresa said in the beginning of this program, if someone leaves the room, I'm never insulted as long as they come back. And you may need to work out with your professor that I can't sit there for this length of time, and I may need to go out, walk around, jump up and down, and then come back in the room. And I will sit in the back so I don't disturb your lecture, but I need to do that. Again, for safety reasons, it was actually my son who was in a chemistry lab that was very long, and he could not stay. And for safety reasons, you couldn't leave your Bunsen burner on. So he had to, he arranged, the TA sat in his space in chemistry lab while he went out for a break and then he came back again. So he was covered, but that arrangement was made, again, ahead of time, knowing that he couldn't do that. He also got off a federal grade. I can't pay attention for a long time. I don't think you want me sitting in the jury box every day for so many weeks. Again, sanction, knowing yourself, not using it as an excuse, but saying, I don't pay attention when I'm sitting here for a long time. So I would be a better student, more attention to, if you let me go walk out there, do run up and down the hallway a few times and come back in. Okay, medications at college. This is, ADHD is a neurobiochemical disorder. We know there are neuroanatomical differences. We know work to regulate what is going on biochemically. We know that these for the medication so that they reduce the symptoms and in some instances improve cognitive functioning, those working memory, processing issues we were just talking about, they can be improved by medication. However, if you don't go to class, taking medication is not going to help you do well on the test. They don't teach you skills. You don't know how to write a better paper on medication, and you don't have any clue as to how to write a paper. You're not organized. It doesn't teach you how to strategize. All these are skills you need to learn. Medication only treats the symptoms of ADHD. Attention span, concentration, focus, distractibility, impulsivity, hyperactivity. You need to learn how your medication works and when you need to take it. And as I always say, ADHD is a 24-hour a day, 7-day a week, 365-day a year disorder. Your ADHD does not stay on the weekend. Therefore, you need your ADHD as well. Again, ADHD does not, the medications do not necessarily improve academic and emotional issues. These need to be addressed separately. And taking a pill doesn't cure everything. And you can't think that just because I take medication, everything's going to be fine when I go off to college. You need to proactively discuss your needs and set up a schedule with your prescribing physician about how you're going to get them on campus, when I should take it, when, what's a good dose for me. You need to discuss new longer-acting medications. I told the story quickly this morning about a patient of mine, a girl who used to break up with her boyfriend every weekend. And I said to her, would you just do me a personal favor and this weekend take your medications on the weekend? She said, okay, I'll do it for you. So she called me up Monday morning and she said, oh, Dr. Quinn, you were right. We had such a wonderful weekend. He said I was so much better this weekend. Again, you know, this is a disorder that affects all your entire life. Unfortunately, we have misconstrued it as an academic disorder. It just affects us at school or work, and it doesn't affect interpersonal relationships or anything. It does. And actually, those almost are more important as to what's going on in our lives. So we discuss longer-acting preparations, which do last. They're actually in the medication like antidepressants that you take in a week date, and you'll always have medication. And there are new longer-acting formulations that last 16 hours and longer. Okay, we already talked about this. Where do you go for refills? What do I do if I have side effects? What about sharing your meds with others? If you share your medications that are prescribed for you with someone else, these are stimulant medications, class 4, control medications, class 3 and 4. It is illegal to distribute these medications. So you are committing a crime when you sell your medication to other people. Quite frankly, for my patients, they understand what medications are doing for them and why they need them. And as a controlled substance, they are only prescribed a certain number. If you give or sell your medication to other people, you will not have it for yourself, and you need your medication for yourself. So be very selfish. You also must keep your medication in the label box with your name on it. You don't put it in an aspirin or ibuprofen bottle. You keep it in the bottle labeled with your name. I suggest that all my patients keep their medications on their person, not in their dorm rooms. And that they understand the consequences of giving away or selling their medication before they leave. Deciding whether to stay or drop out, really very important question for a lot of the students that we've been dealing with. I think it's very important to understand and to look at an honest assessment of why things aren't going for you, to find the best possible match for you, and to see what you need to do. Maybe you need to take a leave of absence. Maybe you need to transfer to another program. Maybe you need to change majors. There are things that you need to do, but you need to take an assessment of what's happening, what's going on. You may need to sit at gap year before you go off to college to gain these skills. So you can be successful smoothly. You know, your friends are going, but when you drop out, they won't care about you. When you fail out, they won't care if you're there or not. So consider that. Again, transferring is more important for some students to see what's going on. And then with the question of dropping out, I because for many students, when they get to this point, they're at a very negative place. And what I like to first say is it's really time at that time to reframe what is going on. You need to look at, again, problem solve. What isn't working here? Why am I in this situation? And maybe it's because I need to make other choices. I need to make other decisions. The example lunch today was a student of mine who was an engineering major. He wanted to be in construction management. He was an engineering major. He failed calculus 2 twice. He retook it, failed it both times. Well, you know what? To be an engineer, you need to take calculus 3 and a lot of other physics courses. He was not going to pass. So instead of dropping out of the school, what we decided to do is to look at how could he achieve his career goal, not as an engineer in construction management, but he transferred to the management class and became a construction management major and became a construction manager, which was a fantastic job for him, by going into management business rather than still. Frame the situation, not thinking of it as a negative and dropping out issue. Again, look at your options at that point. What are your options instead of dropping out? Again, make a plan. Talk to someone, look at your options for a solution. Again, problem solving with people on campus who can help you decide. Don't just walk away from the situation, because that is not going to make anything better if you haven't learned a lesson from what is going on. You need to really investigate. How did I get in this situation? How do I need to change it? Because you're going to be changing jobs, you know, or wives several times during your life if you don't understand how to deal with this situation. Would a withdrawal or reduced cord load be a better option than dropping out? You know, very important issues. Final thoughts for success? Find your inspiration and renew it regularly. When you have ADHD and you have a passion, no one can stop you from being successful. So you need to look at why am I. What am I doing? What inspires me? How am I going to make it in life? What am I doing this for? And dip into that way. And it, again, may be a passion for something completely different than academics that refreshes you and buoys you up to be able to keep going tomorrow. If I go for a bike ride, if I go on my kayak, if I play my saxophone, those things make a difference to me and help me continue. If I talk to a certain person that has been an inspiration, call up this person. If I meet this person, do this. Is there a book that I've read that when I read it, I really feel like I can keep going on? Make sure you seek out contact with people who are inspiring about living and succeeding with ADHD. Who understand that it's a difference, not a disease, and who can help you find your own way to develop yourself. Again, very, very important that they understand you are not ADHD. You're not defined by this disorder. I am not defined by my ADHD. And I think that is a really important way to continue on, to continue learning, to continue making mistakes, to continue being successful. Because we need to understand that we can be successful. Having ADHD is not the worst diagnosis in the world. It's not the worst thing that happened to you. There are a lot of worse things that could have happened to you in life. And what we need to do is to be able to say, I can succeed. This. Just how do I do it? And find someone who can help you and who believes in you that you can do it. And I think that's very important. Remember, there are two sides to the disability coin. One makes it harder to learn, but the other gives you special strengths and allows you to see the world from a different perspective. Embrace it and run with it. It's very, very important to be who you are. I'm very distractible, but I have great ideas. I would never have written so many books. Thank God I have a partner who keeps saying, no, you can't do that. But I think it's very, very important to say, yeah, I might not be able to do this real well. You know, I'm always late, or I forget to pick up my kids. But forgive yourself, don't beat yourself up about it. Rewrite those negative scripts that you have in your head about yourself. To give yourself a break, to forgive yourself, to be able to say, it's okay that I did this. But look what I did over here. I have a wonderful picture that we put on our magazine at Thanksgiving, one Thanksgiving, I'll never forget it. It was a woman who had cooked a turkey dinner for her family. The family was all sitting around. Her little boy had a neatly pressed shirt. She had on pearls. She was leaning over the table, putting the turkey on the table. Everything looked just fine. And then you look closely at the picture. The turkey was still frozen. She had ADHD, got to take the turkey out in time. But we told her to take credit because her boy had a beautifully ironed shirt on. And the table was beautifully set. And her whole family was there. And so give yourself a break. And say, there's a lot more things that are important in life. And there are a lot of things that I can do. And maybe I can even do them better because I have ADHD. Believe that you can be successful in college if you address your ADHD, and you will be.